Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Faith Family Church of God Sunday night service. We're so glad you're joining in with us this evening. If you've not already done so, please like and comment to let us know you're joining in with us. If you're watching on Facebook, don't forget to share this on your Facebook page and in any community pages that you are a member of so we can get the word of God out to those around us, because social media is a very important aspect of witnessing and ministry these days, because everybody has some form of access to social media, right? And so remember to share this on your Facebook page and on the pages that you are a member of so that we can get the word of God out to those around us. If you're watching on YouTube, don't forget to click that subscribe button and then click the bell for notifications when we go live and post content, because there's always something awesome happening at Faith Family Church of God and we never want you to miss out. So make sure to click that subscribe button and then click that bell for notifications. Before we go into our word tonight, let us have a word of prayer. As always, let us welcome the Spirit of God into this word tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you, and we just want to first say thank you for all that you have done for us. Thank you for everything that you have brought us through, God. Thank you for protecting us against everything that has ever come against us up to this point, God, and even in the future, God, for your protection and your provision. Thank you for the promises, the plans that you have for us, God, plans to prosper us and not to harm us, plans for a hope and for a future, God. And we just thank you for your many blessings and provisions, God, even up until this very moment, Jesus. We thank you for your love for us. And thank you for salvation, for the forgiveness of our sins, that all we have to do is just ask of it, God, and receive it. Thank you for everything that you have done for us. Thank you for loving us, even, God, when we are unlovable at times, even when we fall short, you still love us and have grace and mercy and forgiveness for us. Thank you. And Lord, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, we also lift up each and every need that's present here, God, right now. You know the needs that we've been praying over in church and on our Monday night prayer meetings and even in the privacy of our own homes, Lord God, and when we're in our private quiet time with you, whether that's on the way to work or school or whatever we're doing, God, when we take that moment just to pray for whatever situation is going on, Lord, we just ask that you meet each need according to your will and for your glory, God. Let your will be done in each of our lives and in each of our situations, God. Draw us closer to you and draw our family closer to you, God. Meet each need, whether it is spiritual, physical healing, financial blessings, blessings in homes, marriages, in families, God, blessings and direction on jobs and in careers, in school, whatever the need is, God, we know that nothing is too big or too small for you, God, and that you care about everything that we care about. So we cast all our cares on you, God, for you care for us, and we trust and believe for every need to be met according to your will and for your glory, God. And also right now, in the mighty name of Jesus, we come before you and we just ask, God, that you would bless and anoint this time in your word tonight. Bless and anoint me as your messenger, God, as your mouthpiece, God. Use me, speak through me, God. Hide me behind the cross, Lord, and just have your way, Lord, and speak to us what you would have spoken through this word tonight, God, through the word that you have given me for your people, for each of us tonight. Open our hearts, open our minds and our souls and our ears to receive your word. Let us be attentive. Let us receive your word, Lord, and let it just draw us closer to you and grow us stronger in you, Lord God. Give us more of a hunger and a thirst for you more than ever before, that God, that we will dig into your word every day and that we will go deeper into prayer with you and in worship with you every single day, that we'll draw closer to you, God. And Lord, just we ask all these things in your holy, mighty, and precious name, Jesus. And everybody says, amen and amen. Well, again, everybody, welcome to our Sunday night service here with Faith Family Church of God. For those who maybe are joining in for the first time, If you don't know me, my name is Brother Andrew Little. I am the youth pastor here at Faith Family Church of God, and I also preach on Sunday nights. And then my mom, Sister Brenda Little, preaches on the other Sunday nights that I don't preach. But for those who do know me, I'm so glad to see you back on with us this evening. So that being said, let us jump in to our recap of the last time that we were together for Sunday night's word. Last time we talked about 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. There was a lot to take in just in those two verses. We talked about how Paul was warning Timothy how in the last days perilous times would come. We began to discuss the characteristics of mankind living in the fleshly, sinful nature in the end times. And we talked about how these characteristics are even more prevalent today than ever before. We started off by talking about how mankind is lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, and unholy. These are just a few of the characteristics that we discussed the last time that we were together for the word about 2 Timothy chapter 3. So tonight, we're going to go a little further. We're going to discuss 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 3 and 4. You know, there is a whole lot to be taken in. That's why we are breaking it down verse by verse, doing a few verses at a time. Normally, we cover more than this, but there is just so much to take in that we don't want to overlook or miss anything. We want to take it all in bit by bit and absorb it and let it soak within us and let God speak to us through His Word. So let us go tonight to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 3 and 4. It says, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. So, it seems, just if you didn't tune in to the last time that we were talking about this, it seems like we're just coming in abruptly on this, but if you go back and watch what we were discussing last time, or if you remember what we were discussing last time and are tuning in again for tonight, remember that Paul is warning Timothy of how people in the world would become in the last days. Paul tells Timothy that people would be unloving and unforgiving. This is where we're picking up. People in the world used to be so much more understanding and have so much more love for people than they do now. And I'm referring to love both in the family and love for both fellow man and womankind. But people today just don't care for each other like they used to. People used to be so open and friendly to each other, even if they were complete strangers. But these days, people prefer to be isolated, defensive, and introverted when it comes to interactions with others in the world. You know, you can have somebody flash a smile, you know, and then the other person doesn't return it. They look the other way. Or if somebody says, hey, how are you? The other person just clams up. They don't say a word just because they want to stay to themselves. They're not focused on loving others anymore. They're just focused on themselves, which is what the devil wants. He wants separation between God's creation, between all of us. He wants us to be a one-person island, off to ourselves, just focused on ourselves. But why are people this way? This is because of sin. Matthew 24, verse 12, even Jesus tells the disciples of this as a sign of the end times. If you read Matthew 24, verse 12, it says, and because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. So, let's replace the word lawlessness with the word sin. Because sin will abound, the love of many will grow cold. Okay, lawlessness and sin are the same thing. Why will love grow cold as sin abounds? Because God is love. 1 John 4, 7 and 8 says, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. And 1 John 4:20 says, if someone says, I love God, and hates his brother, He is a liar, for he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? So God is love. And if God is love, if we know God, then we come to know love. If we come to know love and experience love, then we can show love. So if God is love, sin cannot be in the presence of God. Because sin cannot be in the presence of God, and since the world is engulfed by the devil and sin these days, then the world does not have relationship with God. And because the world does not have relationship with God like they used to, they do not truly know love. And because they don't truly know God and they don't truly know what love is, they cannot truly convey love to the world around them. That is why there is so much violence in the world these days. So many killings, so much looting, so much political corruption, and so much hatred. Because the world has fallen away from God. Therefore, they have lost the ability to truly love as God calls us to love. A lot of people in the world are also unforgiving these days. Years ago, people were so much more understanding and forgiving than they are now. They used to let stuff just roll off their backs and still love people. But these days, if someone wrongs somebody else, people tend to hold a grudge against the guilty party, and they want to stew in their emotions, and they want to blast the guilty party all over social media. Even we as children of God, when we are wronged by anyone, our flesh wants to get angry. We want to get even. We're tempted to spout off and hold a grudge, being defensive and judgmental about whoever wronged us. But did you know you cannot hold a grudge against somebody and make it to heaven? Did you know that you have to forgive everyone who does wrong against you? Did you know that if you do not forgive everyone who has done you wrong, you will not be able to go to heaven? That is anybody in this world. Why is this? Well, let's look at Matthew 6, 14 and 15. It says, "For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." Ephesians 4:32 says, "And be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you." If we cannot love and forgive others, how can we expect God to forgive us of our sins? The answer is, we cannot. If we cannot love and forgive others, then our sins cannot be forgiven, because God is love and God forgives us all no matter what. And if we do not forgive others, then we cannot receive forgiveness, because we harbor hatred and we harbor unforgiveness within our hearts. So if we cannot love and forgive others, then we cannot receive forgiveness from God, because how can we give what we have not yet received? Therefore, we must learn to love and forgive everyone who has ever done us wrong, and all those who will do wrong against us in the future. Paul then warns Timothy that people will be slanderers against others. We see that a lot in today's time. Slander is the action or crime of making a false spoken statement damaging to a person's reputation. People will sail you down a river in a heartbeat these days. They will run you over, kick it in reverse, back over you, and then drive forward over you again and again, and they will do it without thinking. They either do it as a defensive maneuver when they're caught doing something wrong just to get the attention off of themselves, or they do it because they're jealous of you and want to try to tear you down. They will say whatever they can to try and run you down, making you look bad again while trying to take the attention off of their shortcomings and off of their negativity and wrongdoings. And slander can be either from words spoken or even shared on social media platforms like Facebook or Snapchat. The Bible even speaks against slander. Psalm 101 verse 5 says, "Whoever secretly slanders his neighbor, him I will destroy. The one who has a haughty look and a proud heart, him I will not endure." God does not like it when we speak ill of someone and tear them down. He will not tolerate it. As my great-grandmother on my dad's side used to say, God don't like ugly. It's God's will that we love each other and build each other up and not tear each other down. Matthew 12, 35 and 36 says, "A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. But I say to you that for every idle word men speak, they will give account of it in the day of judgment." Proverbs 10, 18 says, "Whoever hides hatred has lying lips, and whoever spreads slander is a fool." Exodus 20, 16 says, "You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor." This is part of the Ten Commandments of God given to his people. 1 Peter 2, 1 says, "Therefore, laying aside all malice, all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and all evil speaking." Ephesians 4, 31 and 32, "Let all bitterness, wrath, anger, clamor, and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God in Christ forgave you." Slander, bitterness, wrath, anger, all of these things are not of God, but of the devil. It's God's will that we love each other and build each other up. Colossians 3, 5, and 8, "Therefore put to death your members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience, in which you yourselves once walked when you lived in them. But now you yourselves are to put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth." So why did we look at this passage tonight, Brother Andrew? It talks a whole lot more about a whole lot more than slander. But see, slander is considered filthy language from the mouth. Because if God saw fit to instruct Paul to include slander, gossip, spreading lies and filth about one another along with these other sins, then God is telling us that slander is equally as horrible as any other sin that can be committed, and that those who do so are as equally in the wrong as anyone who commits even a sin such as murder. Why is slander as equal as murder in God's eyes? Because slander, although it's not physically murdering a person, it's an attempt to murder a person's reputation, a person's witness, a person's spirit. Physical murder hurts the afflicted person only for as long as they're alive to feel the pain. But slandering, murdering someone's reputation, is felt by the afflicted person for as long as they are alive to remember, because every time they remember what was said or done, or every time someone who was misled by the guilty party's slander looks to the afflicted person, then the affliction feels brand new all over again. Just like that song that we used to sing in children's church. "Oh, be careful, little eyes, what you see." Or, "Oh, be careful, little ears, what you hear. Oh, be careful, little lips, what you say. For the Father up above is looking down in love. Oh, be careful, little lips, what you say." Because if you spread lies and slander about someone, then you can expect it to come back on you. Because you will be judged in the exact same way, and even more harshly, as you have seen fit to harshly judge others whom you have cast down with your mouth and social media posts. Slander not only hurts the afflicted party, and see, the reason why we're talking about this tonight is in this passage of scripture, but the reason why we're looking at this tonight is because the devil wants to create division between God's people. He wants us to be at each other's throats. He wants the church to be at each other's throats so that we can crumble. The church could crumble and not have any effective witness, not have any power, because if we are divided against ourselves, then how can we stand? But slander not only hurts the afflicted party, but if you were the one slandering and tearing down someone else, then you are effectively attempting to commit spiritual suicide. And this is something that God put in my heart. Because if you slander someone and do not repent of it, it will also ruin your reputation, your witness, and can murder your spiritual relationship with God if left unchecked, which would effectively ruin your chance at making it to heaven if you don't repent of what you've done before God. So we must be careful of what we say. We must be careful of how we react. We must be careful of what we say and do. We must be careful to lift each other up, to build each other up, to pray for each other, and not tear each other down. Paul then warns Timothy that people will be without self-control. They will be brutal and despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Self-control is one of the fruit of the Spirit of God. So without the fruit of the Spirit, we can surmise that these people do not have the Spirit of God living within them. There are a lot of people that don't have very much self-control these days. They just do or say whatever comes to their mind, whether it makes sense or not, whether it's good or not. If we don't learn to exercise self-control, then we leave ourselves open to the devil and the temptations that he brings our way. If we don't learn to exercise self-control, we leave ourselves open to anger and malice, which can consume us if we are not careful. And without self-control, anger can lead to brutality, where if someone makes a person mad, that person without any self-control, without the Spirit of God living inside of them as a buffer, they can spout off, they begin yelling and cursing, they can throw things, wanting to throw hands, hurt somebody. This is also why we see so many shootings, stabbings, murders, and lootings, and corruption all over the world. And when Paul tells Timothy that people will be despisers of good, just look at the world around us. Isaiah 5:20 says, "Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter." People these days are happy and comfortable in their sins. The world thinks that it's okay to do whatever you want to do. If it feels good, do it. Everyone thinks that they are the one that God will make an exception for, but his word does not ever change. The world is supportive of alternative lifestyles, but alternative lifestyles are not of God. The world is supportive of abortion, but taking a life, even that of an unborn baby, is not of God. People go to psychics and mediums for help in their lives when they've hit a wall and they don't know which way to go. People flock to bars and to the casinos, as my dad says, to drown their sorrows away and to gamble to try and get more money. People sell their bodies on the streets and in the black market in order to make some money. And there are people who buy time with them just so that they can escape their problems and have a few moments of pleasure. But none of these things are of God. These things do not please God. They are of the devil. Yet people flock to these things amongst many others, seeking to feel good, even just for a moment. But we know that the Bible says sin is good for a season, but in the end it brings forth death and destruction. But when we who have found God, we who have found peace, joy, happiness, and meaning in life because of God, and not just any little g God that the world calls God, because you can say God and the world is not really offended, but if you say Jehovah God, or if you say Jesus, then the world gets offended. But because we who have found peace, joy, and happiness and meaning in life because of Jehovah God and because of Jesus Christ, when we try to spread the message of the gospel of Jesus, the world scorns us. When we try to tell people that all they need is Jesus in their lives, they don't need any of these sinful pleasures and crutches that this world has to offer, they jump down our throats and then call us judgmental. Never mind that we're trying to help them to see that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Never mind that we're trying to help them to see that they're doing nothing but throwing away their time, throwing away their money, putting themselves in debt, and allowing their souls to sink deeper into sin and closer to hell. Never mind that we're trying to help the world to see that if they had Jesus in their lives, they wouldn't need to try to drown out their sorrows. They wouldn't need to try and fill their lives with empty, pleasurable moments. They wouldn't need to throw their money away gambling, trying to get more money. They wouldn't need any of these things because Jesus is peace. Jesus is joy. Jesus owns everything. He provides everything that we need. He protects us. He guides us. He is everything that we need. Does that mean that we're going to have a life that is free of troubles? No. But when trouble comes our way, we don't have to run to these things of the world that the world has to offer. We can run to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who will grab us up in his arms and love us and shower us with mercy and grace and protection and forgiveness, that we won't feel alone, that we won't feel saddened, that we won't feel lost. But when we run to him, we can know we are safe in his arms. And even though our flesh wants to be sad and wants to run to other things, we can say, no, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to feel sad about this. I'm going to leave it in God's hands. I'm not going to run to the world. I'm going to leave it in God's hands, and I'm going to run to God because he's all that I need. And he is going to make a way. Even when I don't see a way, he makes a way for me because he is God. And he has everything under control. Jesus is all that we need. But the world is so lost in sin and deceived by the devil that all they can see is that Christians who follow the biblical standards and who try to spread the message of Jesus Christ, that they consider Christians a group of hateful, judgmental people. The world has been so deceived by the devil that they think they can do no wrong. The world thinks that they don't have to worry about life, and some even think that they can make it to heaven doing what they want to do just because God is a loving God who accepts me just as I am. That's what their worldview is. But they leave off a very important part. Yes, God does accept us just as we are when we first come to salvation through Jesus, but when we ask Jesus into our hearts and become saved, a change is supposed to start taking place. We are supposed to die to our old sinful ways of life, to turn away from those things, to seek after God and to seek to be more like Jesus and God every single day. Seek to do the things that are glorifying and pleasing unto God. People think that they can sin all they want and live the way that they want and make it to heaven just because they maybe walked the aisle at one point. They shook the preacher's hand at one time, or they said the prayer of salvation one time in their lives when they were just a child. But salvation is not a free ticket to sin. Sin cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. If we die in sin, we cannot go to heaven. It's only by the blood of Jesus, by us asking Jesus into our hearts, repenting of our sins, and then by us seeking to follow after God and Jesus every day, seeking to stay away from sin and temptation, that we can make it to heaven. So in these last days, as we close, in a world that has fallen away from God, let us always seek his face. And seek to uphold his standards so that we don't fall to temptation and into sin. Let us love God with all of our heart, all of our mind and our body and our soul. And let us love the world with the love of God. Let us always be merciful and forgiving to everyone around us, no matter what's done. Let us build each other up instead of tearing each other down. And if you don't agree with something someone's doing, try praying for them that God would touch their hearts and their minds. And also, let's pray for ourselves as well, that God would draw us closer to Him and that He would reveal the truth of His word to us on whatever situation that there seems to be a disagreement about. Let us seek to exercise self-control in all that we are faced with and in all that we do, so that we will not give in to flesh or to emotions or temptations when we are faced with hardships, but instead we will stop, just like the old saying is, stop, drop, and roll. We will stop, we will pray, and we will think about the situation and how we should act in a way that is pleasing unto God. Let us not be haughty, and let us not be headstrong so much that we burn bridges and relationships, ruining our witness in the world. And let us uphold what is good and pleasing unto God. Let us shun the very appearance of evil in the world. Everything that the world calls good, let us recognize it as evil and steer clear of it. Let us live our lives as a living witness and testimony in such a way that God uses our lives to shine in the darkness of the world around us, showing the world how we are supposed to live as God's creation. And let us always stay humble before the Lord, seeking His face every day, drawing closer to Him, and let us always remain repentant before God when we fall short, so that we are always ready for whenever the time comes that God calls us home to heaven, so that when that time comes, we can hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord." That is what God wants for each and every person. It's not His will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So let us always remain humble and repentant before God, and let us always seek to be about the Father's business, spreading His love and His grace and mercy and the message of Jesus Christ and His forgiveness for our sins, so that others can have a chance at salvation and coming to know God and Jesus, and coming to know truly what love is, and that they can have a chance at redemption, salvation, and a chance at heaven one glad day. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before You and we thank You for this day. We just thank You for the time, God, that You've allowed us to spend in Your word. And God, we just ask that You would help us to always stay humble before You and before others as well, to seek to love You with all of our hearts, our minds, our bodies, and our souls, and to love everyone around us, God, with Your love. Give us Your eyes, God, that we can see humanity as You see us, that we can love. Give us Your heart, God, that we can love everyone around us with Your love, that we can come together as the body of Christ, as the church, united for the mission that You have given us, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, of Your salvation, Jesus, Your sacrifice and Your love for us, that we who were born in sin have a chance at salvation, have a chance at redemption, being washed white as snow, if we just accept You, Jesus, into our hearts and souls, and that as we seek to be more like You every day and to draw closer to You through the reading and studying of Your word, through praise and prayer and worship to You every day, that as we seek more of you every day, that we will draw away from the sinful pleasures of the world, that we will become more like you and grow more in your love and in your grace, mercy, and forgiveness, so that we can shine forth that which you give to us and willingly give to all who would receive it in this world, that we can shine forth your love, your grace, and your mercy, and spread the message of forgiveness to all who would receive it. Help us, God. Just shine through us, draw us closer to you, make us more like you, and just shine through us in this lost and dark world. Because the devil is trying to do everything that he can to pull people away from you and to keep people from reaching you. The devil is trying to do everything that he can to drag people into hell. But Lord, just use us for your glory. Draw us closer to you, Lord, that we can have the promise of heaven, that we will make it to heaven. But as we seek to make it to heaven and to stay in your presence every day, that we will also, Lord, be open to letting us be used by you for your glory, to spread your message and your love into the world around us, God, that you would just take hold, take control, and that you would work through us in the world around us, so that others would have that chance at redemption and salvation from sin, that the bondage of sin and the hold that the devil has over them and in the world would be broken, and that they would feel your love and grace and mercy and forgiveness, repent of their sins, and be welcomed into the family of God, clothed in your righteousness, their sins forgiven, and that they can have the promise of heaven as they seek to draw closer to you as well. Because, God, we know that it's not your will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So let us all bind together in faith in you and in your love, so that we each can draw closer to you and grow closer together as the body of Christ, that we can help each other, pray for one another, lift each other up, supporting each other on our walks and in our walks in relationship with you, that we can all make it to heaven one day to be with you for eternity. We ask this in Jesus' holy, mighty, and precious name, and everybody says, amen and amen. I love you all so very much. I'm so glad to be able to come together every time to just glean from the Word of God and be in His presence together. Don't forget that tomorrow night, which is Monday night at 6 o'clock, we will have our online prayer. So make sure to send your prayer request into us by the usual means of Faith Family Church of God Facebook page, or if you're a member of the church, it's the FFCOG family's private page, or the special unspoken spoken request group by Sister Marsha, or the Lord is my shepherd encouragers group by Sister Marsha. Or you can always message Pastor Sister Brenda or myself and let us know of your requests. Also, if you have a praise report, we always encourage you to share those with us if you would like to do so as well, because we want to rejoice over what God is doing in your life, because we hurt together as the body and we pray for each other, but we also rejoice together as the body of Christ in what God is doing in our lives. Amen. So again, tomorrow night, Monday night, 6 o'clock for prayer, then Tuesday night, 6:30 for the youth lesson. And of course, all are encouraged to attend, youth and adults alike. But Tuesday night, 6:30 for the youth lesson, and then Wednesday night, 6:30 for Bible study. Again, all are encouraged to attend, all ages, on every service that we have. Monday night, 6 for prayer, Tuesday night, 6:30 for youth class, and then Wednesday night, 6:30 for Bible study. And again, Sunday morning, 10:45 a.m. for morning worship, in person and online, Faith Family Church of God, 3808 Old Brandon Road in Pearl, Mississippi, 39208. We'd love to see you there, and we'd love to fellowship with you and worship with you and glean from the Word of God together. So just let's come together expecting a blessing from God each time, and let's come together expecting to grow in our knowledge of the Word and grow closer to God together. Amen. Amen. Love you all. Have an awesome evening. God bless, and we will see you all tomorrow night for prayer. Amen.